Ramadan Kareem and good evening. So ever since Qatar has won its bid to host the FIFA 2022 World Cup. Could everybody please turn your microphones off so that, you know. So ever since Qatar won its bid to host the FIFA 22 World Cup, debates around migration, labor, and workers' rights have dominated the discussion about this World Cup, right? Appealing to universalizing notions of human rights, important critics have emerged around the treatment of workers, particularly those who have been working to develop the infrastructure for the event. Yet, less has been said about capitalism's structural dependence on racialized labor hierarchies. The panelists today will shift the debate and look at racial capitalism from a transnational perspective and its effect on the lives and experiences of the workers. So today we have in our panel, we have Vani Saraswathi. She is the editor at large and director of projects at Migrants Rights Org. She's also the author of a book, Stories of Origin, The Invisible Lives of Migrants in the Gulf. Then we have Neha Vora, assistant professor of anthropology at Lafayette College, USA. She's well known for her ethnographic works in Gulf region. She authored two books. The first was Impossible Citizens, looking at primarily Indian communities in UAE or Dubai. Her latest book is on education city campuses and the communities, titled Teach for Arabia, American Universities, Liberalism and Transnational Qatar. She has also contributed a number of articles and book chapters, as well as conference presentations based on her ethnographic fieldwork in this region. Then we have Zahra Babar, Associate Director of Research at CIRS at Georgetown University in Qatar. She previously worked for the International Labour Organization and UNDP. She has extensively published in renowned academic journals on issues related to migrants in the Gulf countries, particularly in Qatar. She also appears in public forums and news media to talk about her research and opinion about migrants and migration and migrants' rights. So I would like to thank our panelists for their presence today. And we are so much looking forward to hear from their research as well as fieldwork experience. So without further ado, I would like to invite first Vani Saraswathi to talk about this topic.
Thank you, Hassan. Thanks for hosting me here. I'm not an academic. What I'm going to speak is more into based on the reporting I've done on this issue over the years. I leave it in the capable hands of Zahra and Neha to talk about the racial capital, you know, theory and framework. So I just want to go back 12 years and look at what has changed in the last 12 years since Qatar won the bid to host the World Cup. So in 2010, the population stood at 1.8 million. As of March 2022, that's last month, the population is 2.8 million. The economically active workforce, that's those above the age of 15, are 2.1 million, 95% of whom are non-Qataris, the majority employed in low-income sectors, and they come primarily from countries in Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, but in the last 3-4 years from Africa as well. This also means the majority of the residents here are not literate in Arabic, do not have a sense of social belonging. And even though they are the numerical majority, live in the margins. It's easy to dismiss this as saying that's where the cheapest labor come from, but we've seen an increasing move to recruit away from other Arab countries. And I'm not going to interpret that too much, but just to keep that in mind. And also to talk about the huge difference in, you know, in the sex ratio. So 80% of the total male population in the 80% of the total population in the country is male. When it comes to migrants, it's again about 90%. All of this data is disaggregated as Qataris versus non-Qataris, right? There's no official information on the nationalities of non-Qataris, not because it's not available. Keep in mind the Qatar ID number has a nationality component. Three digits in that is the country you come from. So the data is available, it's not made public. This makes it appear as if there are only two categories, two layers of hierarchies. But we know that there are multiple ethnicity and gender-based hierarchies that are overlooked in everything, including urban planning and policy making. Just keep these figures in mind as I cover a few more issues. So there has been a lot of hue and cry, rightly so, on the human rights abuse of migrant labor in the country, and not dissimilar to the rest of the GCC states, which are all highly dependent on migrant labor to build, operate, and sustain their economies and the country itself. But the criticism has been too narrow and too simple in the case of Qatar, with the usual tropes of lack of democracy, not cultured enough, corruption, is an Arab country ready to host an event of this magnitude? But who are the people actually profiting from this? Is it just Qatar, the Emirate? Who are the other stakeholders who need to be held accountable? World Cup related infrastructure projects are valued at $300 billion, US dollars, and about 10 billion are on stadiums alone. The projects that are closely related to World Cup employ just about 30 to 40,000 workers. Everything else that's being built around don't fall strictly under the World Cup projects. But the growth and ambitions don't end come December. According to industry-specific intelligence reports, the construction market will be valued at close to 80 billion by 2026 in Qatar, with an average annual growth of 10.5% over the next 4 or 5 years. That means there'll be, you know, the projects that will come up, the money that is to be made in Qatar is more or less unparalleled, barring a few projects in Saudi. So who are the people winning these projects? Who are the people building it? The power lies in a handful of powerful local businesses, family-run businesses, whose, you know, their participation is reflected in the Shura Council, in the Business Council. So these are really powerful players. They either bid and win independently or as joint ventures with some of the largest international players in the world, from France and Italy, US, UK, Japan, South Korea. All of these big corporations bring in their technical know-how. They quite easily compromise on the rights of those whom they employ, recruiting cheap and from afar with little or no accountability. Criticism raised in this regard are often countered with project-specific welfare standards that are put in place, be it the Supreme Committee for the World Cup Project or Qatar Foundation for American Universities. The simplest way in which they counter the criticism is to say the people working in our projects will be taken care of. But these are world-class standards, no doubt, but it's not the law. The penalty for non-compliance is losing a bid or being blacklisted for a while. It does not hold in the court of law. So you have companies with duplicitous standards who are contracted for these projects. The employees working on these big projects will enjoy a better condition of living and working, and the rest of them will suffer. Have things changed overall in the past 12 years, besides the increase in construction work and population? Yes and no. We've seen legislative reforms, though lacking in implementation and lacking in sound grievance mechanisms. We also saw an unprecedented openness to international media, international NGOs and UN mechanisms, while local media and civil society continue to be strangled, they're non-existent. We can have a panel like this in English, hosted by an American university in Qatar, but there would be more censorship in the Arabic mass media. So there's a dichotomy that, you know, we kind of have come to accept. We also saw a technical cooperation with the ILO and new labor standards being introduced. Yet, of the four fundamental principles of the ILO, three remain unmet: freedom of association and collective bargaining, elimination of forced labor, and elimination of discrimination in employment. These three fundamental principles still are not enforced in the country. but we have an ILO technical cooperation, we have an office. Instead, we see voluntary joint committees and welfare standards that give corporations the power and responsibility that ideally should be that of the state. Of course, this is the hallmark of successful capitalist economy. So we are moving away from binding commitments, from laws, to feel-good CSR-ish initiatives, which will always centralize profitability over rights. But what does all this mean for the close to 2 million low-income workers who are continuously and deliberately excluded from socio-cultural and economic participation? Let's take the financial aspect. The non-discriminatory minimum wage is set at QR 1000. That's just a little over $300. That low minimum will only apply to those from certain countries holding certain passports. Wage discrimination, however, is pervasive across all classes and sectors of workers. You could be a professor at Education City or an engineer or a CEO. Your salary will not be determined by your experience or by your qualification, but from where you come. Going back to the 1,000 rial minimum wage, in order to survive in this country with one of the highest cost of living in the world, a family of four needs a minimum of 11,000 rials without rent, and an individual needs close to 4,000 rials without rent. But when a minimum wage is set so low, it is an explicit admission that the employer, the big businesses, will control the lives of those they employ. They'll provide them food, accommodation, transportation, and when they fail to do so satisfactorily, filing a complaint or raising one's voice would mean to lose even those minimum protections, be rendered homeless, in poverty, and with little or no option but to leave the country, giving up all claims or hopes of justice. For those who earn the lowest, they do not even have an option to independently open a bank account in order to save a nest egg, as their salaries are too low to do so. Their account would always be linked to the employer under the WPS, which means every penny they earn is remittance. They have no financial security where they live and work. We saw this particularly during the pandemic when salaries were cut or salaries were not paid. Workers had to bring money back home, back from their home countries to survive. And they couldn't leave Qatar either at that point. But that exclusion is almost deliberate. We know that the majority of residents in the country are Asian and increasingly African workers, yet they are not represented in the media or allowed to participate fully in what the country has to offer, either because they can't afford it or because they're ghettoized and not allowed into the family areas. When I moved to Qatar in 99, and for about the first 10 years, there were areas within Doha city that were mixed. You had Qatari families, you had people of different income levels living there. But all of that has been gentrified. There's a neighborhood regeneration program that has erased all of it and pushed single, the so-called bachelors, outside where they won't be seen. Exclusion also comes up in other ways. For the tens of thousands of Indians, Nepalis, and Sri Lankans of non-Abrahamic faiths, there are no places of worship. So you're constantly being reminded of your temporariness, of the transactional nature of your residence in this country, even if you've lived here for many years. When they are represented, they are seen as recipients of charity or the beneficiary of a richer country. Their critical and primary role as nation builders who are indispensable is hidden and masked behind these covert racial practices. Worst of all, the policing of these discriminatory practices is also done by other low-income migrants. As guards and supervisors and middle managers, they maintain the status quo, while the more affluent, both Qataris and non-Qataris, can avoid the elbow grease. So you'll have them, you know, the Indian policing the Nepali, Nepali policing the African. And then we have the whole other minefield, which I'm not even going to be able to do justice to, I know I'm running out of time, of gender intersecting with racial discrimination, be it the invisibility and isolation of female migrant domestic workers or the stereotyping of women migrants in service sector. In the case of domestic workers, in lieu of the state's responsibility and investment to provide social welfare services, their recruitment and employment is outsourced to individual households at nominal costs with very little accountability on that employer. this again is what, you know, we see it in a larger scale where this is outsourced to corporations and in a smaller scale outsourced to individual households. There are so many problems that arise because of this. We've already spoken about the sex ratio in the country and the number of migrants in the country. So what this ends up doing is when men outnumber women by such large numbers, there is a double-edged marginalization. Mm-hmm. Single brown men are policed and excluded from public spaces, and single women's mobility is controlled and monitored without even an attempt at a long-term solution of how this could be more equal, the society could be more equal. And I specify single brown men because you will not see that being applied to single white men or single Arab men. So it's very specifically to men coming from Asia and Africa who are excluded from these spaces.
Yeah.
And just the last line. So the equality that we want in order to break this racist capitalism will come at the short-term cost and profitability for big businesses. But it's not a negotiation that is welcome. It is not a negotiation that was launched in the last 12 years when the spotlight was on Qatar. So I'm not quite sure if you'll be able to do it going forward either. Thank you, and sorry if I took more time.
It's okay, Vani. We really enjoyed your grounded experiences. So it was good to start with what actually goes on about migrants' treatments, and which sparked a lot of interest in public as well as among academics. And so now we have time to hear from academics in our panel. We'll start with Zahra. She will mostly focus on what racialized capitalism means and how it affects the experiences that we hear from Vani Saraswathi. So Zahra Babar.
Thanks so much, Hassan. And thank you to my friends and colleagues at NUQ for inviting me to be part of this panel. And thank you also, Vani, for doing that amazing overview of what things look like in Qatar right now. I've been in Qatar for about 14, I've been here longer, but for the past 14 years or so, I've been focused in trying to understand, examine, learn about labor migration governance in Qatar and in the region. And so I'm going to shift the discussion a little away to focus more specifically on the racialized labor market that is evident in Qatar. You don't have to be deeply ingrained in studying migration in the region or an expert. It's something that I think within a few weeks or months of living in Qatar, you would quickly be aware of, that the labor market looks particularly stratified along racial and national lines. If you look at this, if you're examining or taking a look at the higher tiers of the labor market, the professional white collar jobs where skilled and highly skilled workers are seeking their jobs, then that looks fairly diverse. The upper tiers of Qatar's labor market would comprise of Qatari citizens, Western expatriates, skilled Africans, Asians, people from all over the world. But it's when you go down into the lower tiers of the labor market, particularly the lowest tier, where most of the labor is of a physical or manual nature. And that segment of the labor market is also the largest segment that employs migrant labor. The largest cohort of migrants in Qatar are working in that segment. Those sorts of jobs in the construction sector, in facilities cleaning, management, security, domestic work, food and beverage, lower tier hospitality, those jobs, that sector is extremely non-white and migrant heavy. Primarily, it is South Asians, Southeast Asians, increasingly, as Vani has mentioned, people from Africa who are working in these jobs. And in certain job categories, there are certain nationalities which are even overrepresented. So for example, in the security sector, right? Security guards in Qatar, there's a very high representation of migrant workers from East Africa and from Nepal. The domestic sector, of course, we are well aware of. Women from the Philippines are vastly overrepresented in that category. Now, in terms of the sort of explanations that have been given for why the labor market looks like this, why it looks like, why it is so stratified, particularly by national, ethnic, and racial origin at the lower tiers, there are different levels of analysis. I mean, there's academic scholarship. There's a lot of work that's examined not just Qatar's labor market, but the GCC regional market of labor markets to try and explain why they look like this. The academic work has largely consisted of offering explanations which are driven by sort of political, economic, social, and cultural conditions. A lot of the explanations are tied to the also Qatar's particular the geography of the Gulf, Qatar's geography, as well as, you know, demographic constraints. The Gulf countries, by and large, and smaller ones like Qatar, had small populations. With the discovery and exploitation of hydrocarbon resources, they had booming developmental agendas, and they had to source labor from the near abroad and the not so near abroad, but basically the neighborhood and the larger neighborhood. So most of, you know, these explanations have sort of fixed on the reason why there's so many South Asian workers in these jobs is because they, you know, the countries of origin do not have thriving economic conditions. These are workers are surplus to their domestic economies. They are drawn to the Gulf. They're, you know, there are lots of jobs available here. So it's sort of like that economic rationalization of why this occurs. Beyond, you know, academic explanations, if one, you know, if this, from the state perspective, a policy perspective, if questions are raised or, you know, did they sort of draw attention is drawn to the fact that this labor market looks like it's stratified, you know, racially or, you know, along nationality lines. The explanations are or offered are usually that this is nothing deliberate. We do not operate a sort of, you know, migration policies which are deliberately like focusing on drawing migrants from, you know, particular racial backgrounds or particular source countries. A lot of this depends on the market conditions, its employers. Employers have their own preferences. Companies choose where to find the best workers that they need. And, you know, this, they pass it to the sort of to that level. And, you know, from the employer's perspective, frequently the response is, again, you know, we are not operating in any sort of deliberately racialized way. We source workers who have the correct skills, the right aptitude, and frequently the right attitude to perform certain work. But while all of these explanations have a degree of truth to them, and a lot of the academic work that has studied the Gulf labor market and Qatar's labor market is rooted in, you know, proper research and scholarship, the generally scholars of migration, most of us who work on migration in the Gulf, are feeling we need more than this. We need to understand this in a different way. We, first of all, these racializations in labor markets are not unique to Qatar, and they are not unique to the Gulf. Across the world, and particularly in countries which are very dependent on, heavily dependent on sources of migrant labor for certain, you know, segments of their labor market, we see the same patterns occurring. And so there has been a general press from, you know, scholars to seek alternate or additional and more nuanced explanations. Because despite all of these various, you know, be it the academic examinations and the sort of government responses, the main thing that these accounts suggest is that none of this is deliberately racial. None of this is deliberately racialized. It's a natural occurrence, and it's just a sort of non-deliberate consequence. But despite this, much is known anecdotally and, you know, through all the ethnographic accounts that we have, that racial stereotypes define Gulf labor markets. Migrants are, feel them, live them. And the effect of these racial stereotypes and tropes is clearly demarcated, not only in popular discourse, but in, you know, migrants' lived experiences and also official job categories and visa statuses and the kinds of titles you're allowed to have in jobs and a whole bunch of stuff. So basically, the contemporary techniques, practices, infrastructures of labor migration and the governance, as well as these enduring racialized patterns of migration in the region, cannot be understood simply as a result of global inequalities, of uneven patterns of development between sending and receiving states, nor as a, you know, consequence of just near local political economic conditions. And that's where applying the racial capitalism framework or lens really helps us, because it helps us to untangle racialized and exploitative labor structures in the Arabian Peninsula by situating them within a global economic system that is intimately tied to legacies of slavery, colonialism, and explicitly racialized forms of capital accumulation that, you know, occurred across the Indian Ocean world from like the 19th century. Racial capitalism allows us to consider how race infuses social structure that is emergent from capitalism, right? Racial capitalism is not suggesting that capitalism at its core is like this, you know, deeply racist project, a mega project, but it is saying that racialization of labor occurs as a result of capital accumulation. In applying the lens of racial capitalism to Qatar and the Gulf, it allows us to be more attentive to understanding local patterns of racialization that move beyond accounts, these sort of essentializing accounts of, you know, authoritarianism and oil development. And there's a growing body of work, Neha has done a considerable amount of it, that is refocusing some of our attention backwards in time, arguing that, you know, colonial structures and processes are crucial to understanding the contemporary labor migration, particularly from South Asia to the Gulf. Scholars have demonstrated already how labor migration from the Indian subcontinent was channeled to various lucrative corners of the British sphere of influence, and the very distinctive role that South Asian labor came to play in fueling processes of capital accumulation globally. At one, you know, at one point, this could be taking place in the West Indies, at another in Malaya, and at other points in the Persian Gulf. The movement of Indian workers around the empire was built on a set of racial ideas about the inherent qualities of Indian labor and its role in capital accumulation. This was happening in other parts of the world under colonialism. Similar mobilities were being racialized. Going back to much earlier work by Samir Amin, who looked at this in the context of coercive labor migration within regions of Africa. I am going to switch over to Neha in a second, but I just want to say one last thing. For me, one of the important reasons, and something that I think makes racial capitalism really an important lens, it's not just the fact that it expands the space temporally and spatially for us to understand racialized labor hierarchies here, but it's because of the special attention we need to give to how racial devaluation of labor occurs in the Gulf, the processes and practices through which migrant labor is reproduced with racialized differential value, right? So in Qatar, there's a kind of hierarchical ordering of migrant society. Some categories of migrants are evaluated up, right? So they are actually endowed with greater resources, privileges, and enhanced capacities, whereas other categories of migrants are racialized down. They are devalued, and this serves to legitimate patterns of exploitation and, you know, all the things that Vani pointed out. So I'm going to stop now and hand over to Neha and continue the conversation.
So thank you, Zahra, for your wonderful overview to understand racialized capital from a more theoretical point of view. I just want to highlight one point in Zahra's speech that, as she explained, this racialized capitalism does not depend on an individual or a group of individuals' intention. It is by design. It is in the design of capitalism itself. So just keep this in mind when we hear our discussions points and we try to think about it. So we will go on to Neha Vora and her ethnographic experience about migrants in this region. We would get more understanding about how this structure racializes these migrants and affect the experience they have in this region. Neha Vora.
Thank you so much. I want to thank Hassan and Torsten and NUQ for putting this panel together. I think it's very important. And thank you to my co-panelists for setting this up amazingly. And I hope I don't overlap too much in terms of what I'm going to say. So my comments today are going to draw on research in both Dubai and Doha, where I was able to witness the other side, which is the role of expatriate employers in reproducing systems of inequality. And I draw here particularly on two articles about race in the Gulf that I've recently published with Amélie Le Renard. And in addition, I'm going to read from portions of a co-written piece with Zahra about the human rights gaze on Qatar 2022 that is currently in the publication process. So speaking from the outside, I see a lot of media representation of Qatar 22, a lot of human rights discourses that are very hyperbolic at the expense of the kind of very careful, detailed work that Vani is doing. So the international attention the World Cup has brought to Qatar and the Gulf region has highlighted some of the racisms that undergird regional labor economies. And a global awareness raising campaign has been framed as offering correctives to this system. Yet the human rights discourses surrounding World Cup 2022 continue to also paint a picture of Gulf exceptionalism with undercurrents of Orientalism and Islamophobia. Human rights approaches often lead with the presumption that intervention from the outside international community is the only solution to solving Qatar's problems with migrant rights, when similar labor conditions in global north countries, countries whose citizens most often produce journalistic, activist, and scholarly accounts of the Gulf, are not framed as violations of human rights or as problems that require international attention. It is important to analyze labor conditions in Qatar as part of a globalized economic order, as Zahra was speaking about, built on colonialism and racial capitalism. But it is simultaneously important to pay attention to how non-governmental and international human rights discourses are themselves often legitimized through the same histories and relations of power that shape immigration, race, and employment stratification in today's globalized economy. Racialized capitalism is a framework that allows us to see the development of how the development of capitalism was predicated on ideas of fundamental hierarchies between humans, how class has always been raced, and how labor's value is tethered to differentiated understandings of human bodies and their capacities. The development of capitalism and wage labor in Europe was predicated on unfree labor in the form of chattel slavery and indenture in the colonies. And within the vast network of the British Empire, Indian and Chinese laborers were particularly racialized as buffers between Black and white, free and unfree. In the Arabian Peninsula and Indian Ocean, Indian labor was policed in specific ways to keep nationalities apart, prevent collective action, and reproduce racial hierarchies. These imperial forms and the networks that sustain them shape migration laws in both post-colonial India and the emerging Gulf states, and their legacies can be seen in the kafala system and the many middlemen, secondary industries, states, and corporations that sustain racialized labor stratification and suppress workers' rights. An extensive body of work, including mine, has examined how the kafala worker sponsorship system that is now institutionalized, previously understood through orientalizing explanations, tracing its roots to indigenous Bedouin Arab traditions, was actually founded through British colonial practices for controlling labor and mobility. And as we've spoken about already, employers, manpower agencies, both sending and receiving states continue to profit from a nationally and racially differentiated labor system. However, I'm moving away in my thinking from calling this kafala, because I think that calling it kafala is one of the ways that we separate out labor and immigration in the Gulf as somehow unique in the world. And it deters us from seeing how the current Gulf labor market demonstrates a racial ordering built not on timeless indigenous customs and authoritarianism, but a localization of transnational practices of racial capitalism. The idea that migrants move temporarily, are not welcome into the social fabric, are only remitting, are not localized to the Gulf. In fact, they are becoming the most common form of migration in the world. In the case of Qatar, shaming the state has been the primary tactic of activists and journalists to leverage the World Cup as a venue for raising awareness of the plight of migrant workers, especially under this rubric of modern day slavery. Not only does this approach elide grassroots and state efforts to reform labor and immigration practices, it reproduces stereotypes about Gulf citizens that alienates them from the international community and from being stakeholders in the process of ameliorating labor conditions. But most problematic is the oversimplification of the story of migrant workers in Qatar that ignores the impact of racialized patterns of capital accumulation taking place in the Gulf and globally. Human rights frameworks suggest that the poor conditions for migrants occur because Qatar lacks political and economic will to change conditions. Racial capitalism extends our analytic gaze horizontally and temporally and suggests instead that the undervalued and racialized labor of workers is critical to the functioning of a far larger system of capital accumulation that has historically exploited brown and black work in multiple locations. So I think it's more important for us to see Qatar as a node in a transnational system of capital production that is built on deeply racialized inequalities. Systemic issues persist so that in Qatar, wage differentials that provide the highest wages to citizens and Western expatriates and the lowest wages to Asians and Africans continue to be justified, as are multiple other inequalities and differentiations related to access to benefits, paid time off, annual home leave, education, health, et cetera. These occur not merely because the state fails to create and uphold necessary laws to protect lower income migrants, but because of the actions of private actors and internal human resource policies that are deliberately deployed along racial lines and driven by profit motives. Qatari businesses and multinational corporations generate profit by using cheap migrant labor and labor that has been made deliberately cheap due to its racially undervalued economic designation. So if we take the work of someone like Amélie Renard, for example, who just published a book on Western, why am I blanking on the name of the book? I'm sorry. But it's like in French it's occidental something, but like I forget the name in English. So what she does in that book that's really interesting, she has done field work in Dubai, but she looks at how inside of the corporation itself, the people who are making the decisions to hire certain nationalities into certain roles are most often white expatriates, at least in the research that she's done. So it's really important for us to understand the role of consultants and well-paid expatriate managers in reproducing the system in which nationality seems to map onto certain kinds of forms of employment versus others. And it's another way of creating segregation to prevent collective action. So profits are made starting not just when the migrant comes into the Gulf, but from the home country itself, right? The labor recruitment industry that extracts illegal and raw profit from migrants competing for blue collar jobs in the Gulf is well documented, though less attention is given to the legal costs that are extracted from migrants in the form of numerous bureaucratic procedures deemed necessary for their safe migration. As Andrea Wright has shown in her research on the oil industry in the Gulf, multiple public and private actors are involved in facilitating Gulf migration, from the private health centers in sending countries where migrants undergo pre-departure medical screening, to the facilities that provide identity authentication in the form of biometric scans, to the skill development and accreditation centers that provide migrants with the requisite paperwork to demonstrate to Gulf employers that they are well equipped to carry out their jobs. Racial capital accumulation occurs in Qatar and in migrants' home countries, not only due to the profit extracted from migrants selling their labor cheaply, but also through other migrants buying the right to sell their labor cheaply. Without a buy-in from a range of actors and agencies involved in labor immigration, such as sending states, recruitment agents, managers, large-scale corporations, it is not likely that reforms will be universally applied or that new illegal practices will be adequately deterred. I'm just going to quickly wrap up. So what the international coverage of labor migration following the World Cup bid and much of the scholarly literature on Gulf labor have in common is the tendency to analyze labor conditions, urban development, and social stratification through the lens of authoritarian nation states. This approach exceptionalizes labor in the Gulf rather than considering how the current state of labor and migration is a product of these historical and contemporary transnational assemblages that include multiple stakeholders, of which state officials and agencies are but one part. In addition, national nationality has been naturalized as the justification for differential pay and treatment of workers. But several scholars have tracked how nationalities themselves are racialized forms of mobility and immobility in the contemporary world. In the case of the Gulf, we can see that nationalities become racialized forms of knowledge that exceed the group they are referencing and are applied to those who don't necessarily fall into that national affiliation. So for example, Amelie and I have written a piece on the category Indian in the Gulf and how it is used as a racial signification that includes people that might not be from India, but also doesn't necessarily include people like me, right? Moreover, immigrants actively contribute to Gulf economies and practice forms of consumer citizenship. Basing pay on home country standards erases the vibrant participation of immigrants in the production of Gulf societies. And this calculus seems to only apply to low-paid Black and Brown workers from the Global South. No one makes arguments that British and Canadian citizens are paid too much according to their home country standards. All right, so basically, I just want to sum up by saying that unless we're taking a transnational lens to kind of think about where the profit is, as Vani was talking about, and how the exploitation begins, not at the moment of like becoming employed in the Gulf, but through this longer process, it just really doesn't make sense that labor conditions will be ameliorated by targeting the state and legislation from the state. And I'll just leave it at that and we can open up for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Neha, for your wonderful presentation. And we are opening the forum for questions from our audience. Anyone who is in, who has a question can raise your hand or alternatively, you can post your question on the chat box and we will get it to panelists. So while our audience raise their questions. I have a common question to all three of our panelists. So racialized migrant labor or migrant worker, right? So this is an exceedingly academic term. Most people don't really have adequate understanding of what this racialized mean. Anyone can pick it up and explain in brief, in common, you know, commonsensical language, what do you mean by this?
I can take a stab at it. So the folks that work on racial capitalism that I draw from, like people like Lisa Lowe, for example, who's a theorist of colonialism, looks at how our modern categories of understanding difference as race, the way that colonial categories of race were based in ideas of fundamental biological differences between groups of people, right? How those kinds of ideas develop at the very same time that capitalism is starting to become the mode of production. So it's a challenge to people like Marx who are saying that class is the only divider that produces the kinds of unequal conditions that happen under capitalism. And what people like her and Cedric Robinson and other folks are saying is that actually capitalism is fundamentally predicated on this idea of racial difference. And that is continual. It's taking place in Europe even prior to bringing in the colonial framework, that there people who end up in the working class in Europe are themselves coming from what we would now call racialized backgrounds. So it's a way of complicating a solely class-based Marxist analysis of why labor exploitation happens. I don't know if that was not very academic though.
No, still it makes sense if Zahra and Vani has something to add to it. Okay, Zahra, yeah.
No, sorry, I was gonna say, I think Neha did a perfect job. Okay.
When we think about capitalism, we think in terms of class from classical Marxist one. So this is a new way of understanding capitalist system and people's experience within this capitalist system along race line. So race becomes one of the primary, you know, divide between people. So this is what we, yeah, go ahead, yeah. Vani.
it's not so much trying to de-academize racial capitalism, because I don't think I have enough knowledge for that, but just to say the way to control large numbers of people is to make sure they're as other as possible. So it's in terms of how they look, what they eat, how the languages they speak, the religions they belong to. And we've seen a shift away across the Gulf, specifically in Qatar, recruiting people from countries where Arabic is the main language or whose practices may be reflected here. So you bring in a large number of people who are really foreign, and then you can also justify it under the belief that it's for national security and it's for maintaining national identity that you're going to marginalize them. And this actually profits big businesses, right? It profits in terms of financial gains. This works out very well, because if you don't have a sense of belonging, you're not going to demand your rights. You will just put your head down, work, not complain, and move away.
This is wonderful, actually very helpful to understand. I mean, of course, it is not de-academized.
I think, again, one of the points is that the racial capitalism literature is quite clear that it is not the same as studying race or racism, right? That those are different histories also. That the other thing is that in terms of, like, some scholars who are actually using racial capitalism to try and unpick some of the challenges around migrant labor. I read a really interesting piece on a woman looking at migrants in Brazil, suggest adopting, as Neha has suggested, like a global network approach to actually follow the production of a particular, you know, the way a particular capitalist network functions and how migrant labor is embedded in it. So that the guilty parties, the people who are actually engaging in this form of racialized exploitation of workers, they might not even be aware of being explicitly engaged in racist behavior. So there is a distinction. But one of the, so I think that's something that is complicated, but one has to think through who is culpable, who is to blame. This doesn't purport to come up with an easy solution to it, but it's actually seeking to, you know, broaden our understanding of who we identify as being culpable in creating some of this, right? And, you know, like, again, to build on what Neha said, Vani has done a really great elaboration of the challenges in Qatar. And we all understand that the production of a cheap, biddable, racially devalued workforce in Qatar, you know, it must be situated to some extent within the local context of power. This is always relevant. Obviously, things have to be done. But the kinds of interventions, be they like the dream intervention of, you know, having trade unions or some form of representation for workers, enhancing labor standards, increasing general protections, labor protections for migrant workers based in Qatar is necessary. We're not going to address this sort of racialization and the racially devalued worth of their labor. That is not going to be addressed by solutions that are just Qatar specific.
Thank you, Zahra.
I see that Sammy has his hand up, but can I just interject one more thing? Okay. I think building on what Vani was saying about this othering process, right? We see a parallel, like, so there's while labor migrants are being othered in particular ways as foreign, is a simultaneous time when national identity is being purified of all of these historical cosmopolitanisms, right? So we can't necessarily look historically and say there's no Indian presence in the Gulf, right? That we can't. It's been a purification process of othering Indian as distinct from Khaliji. Khaliji comes up as an identity through defining what it's not, right? And the way that these kinds of labor differences in wages and treatment are justified is through this term nationality. And that just kind of, it's a smokescreen, because what nationality does is it presumes, oh, we all have a nationality, right? These are like, as if these are coeval things, but we know that the development of nationality as a concept in and of itself is through the desire to racially limit who gets to move where. So nationality becomes this kind of way that people justify differential treatment, but nationality itself is raced. Okay, I'll leave it at that. Mm-hmm.
Sammy.
Yeah, hi, thanks everyone for this fantastic talk and really insightful. And I guess I have two comments or two points that I want to make. One is, I wonder if then this is just a problem of scale rather than like a problem of kind, in the sense that, you know, you don't have in, let's say, the US, right, you might have some of these similar processes, right, and racial capitalism and so on and so forth. But the fact that you have such a huge amount of labor that of a particular type compared to sort of other sections of society, or the sort of citizen versus resident, you know, perhaps creates this kind of, you know, question of scale that makes it much more sort of in your face. So I just wonder what you think about that. And then the other thing I wanted to comment on or just ask you about is this question of like what to do with this, right? And then you know, the question, I think you probably face this multiple times, of like this kind of gets the government kind of off the hook, right? It seems to me that it's very easy for, you know, human rights organizations or The Guardian or whatever to just kind of point to the government, right? It's this very clear cut, and you can get people to rally around that sort of flag or that cause. And you know, what do you do then with this, you know, when you say it's a lot more complicated, right? Can have this effect of, well, then getting the government off the hook. And I mean, I you know, perhaps The Guardian, or that nobody ever comments on, you know, the international corporations. So maybe, you know, I'm perhaps answering my own question here, but I think, you know, one of these questions of making it more complicated or blaming capitalism then becomes, you know, well, what do you do with that? How do you create a movement, right, around that? And I think many of us sort of face this, is that, you know, how do you think about labor, even in our own institution, and how do you sort of mobilize and so on? So just some, if you care to comment.
Yeah, I'll take a stab at it, a small stab. No, absolutely, Sammy. But I think that's one of the things I've actually been interested in looking at, what scholars are doing in trying to position this, as this is not just a, like, let's deconstruct things to death and leave ourselves in a position where there are no options. It's just a, you know, academic exercise. I think there is intent, a deliberate intent, when it comes to applying racial capitalism to migration globally, to studying migration globally. And it's not just about making visible these sort of complexities and where this racialization occurs. I think there is an ability to making these sort of things visible, that you can start finding ways or to highlight strategies, to identify new forms of solidarity and resistance. I think that is possible, but it probably has to be embedded in studying something in a systematic fashion. So, like, either through studying one labor migration corridor, you know, one country, sending country to the receiving states, to all stages of it, to see where these things are occurring, or similarly, actually follow the money, follow one of, you know, a global production network again. So I don't think it is only about, yes, it's partially about making sure we're trying to complicate how we see things. And it's certainly not about denying the fact that conditions in these receiving states are terrible and need to be addressed. But it is, I think it comes from, you know, this sort of feeling that, you know, these situational interventions are only going to put a sort of band-aid on it. You might immediately help people here, but there's streams and streams who keep coming, and they have for decades, and those conditions are not ameliorated, right?
So
I just want to add a point to what Zahra said and to Sammy's thing. I think international corporations are being held accountable. There have been cases filed against them, against Vinci in France, for instance. So you do have some amount of reporting. And while I agree that this trend of, you know, the kafala-esque immigration system is spreading across the world, we also need to keep in mind that what the Gulf countries, including Qatar, lack absolutely is civil society space, right? So when things go bad, as it might in the US or in Europe, there aren't these support systems that will step in and help people, provide legal aid, provide, you know, relief. None of this exists. In fact, it's criminalized when you do this. So we need to keep that in mind. And this is why governments need to be held most accountable. Even if at times the reporting seems unfair, they control everything. They make sure the media is not free, that nobody is reporting about what happens on the ground. We are dependent on foreign media flying in to do it. So, I mean, whom do you blame for that? We need to kind of look into that as well.
Thank you, Vani. There are a couple of questions on the chat box. I would like to take at least one of the questions before I move on to those who raised hands. So Sana asked about kafala system, and her question is basically the study of labor practices or kafala in the region, does it have to be de-essentialized? Would such an approach lead to a meaningful reform or solutions?
I think the point is not that there's not something unique about the Gulf immigration and labor system. It's just that it's not exceptional, right? Like that the kinds of practices that you see, the forms of exploitation that you see happening in the Gulf are perhaps intensified, but also perhaps the spotlight is showing them in a way that we don't see in other places. For example, what are the labor conditions like for poor people in India? And how often is that highlighted in the same way that it's highlighted in the Gulf, right? Poverty in India becomes something that is like a natural disaster. The state has no responsibility over it. But the Indian state is responsible for a lot of the conditions that lead to the sending of migrants to the Gulf. And the Indian state also has put in measures to depoliticize those people. They can't vote once they're NRIs, et cetera, right? So why are we not simultaneously holding the Indian state accountable for the same kinds of things, or the US state? I mean, Sammy said this kind of stuff doesn't necessarily happen as much in the US, but that's not true. I mean, our entire agricultural industry is based on the exploitation of temporary migrant workers, many of whom are undocumented. But because we're a democracy and because the human rights sort of gaze doesn't necessarily fall on the global north countries in the same kind of way, those things become invisibilized.
Yeah, wonderful. Thank you. So one more question from the chat box, and then I will move on to the raised hands. So Lavan, I believe she's from Nanyang Technological University. So she asked a question about a hierarchical system in the existing labor practices, which involves processes of othering and devaluation. So how does the skill or merit speak to the notion of racial capital and racialization?
Neha, why don't you take this? You've written on this.
Yeah, so actually, you can trace that back to the colonial system and the way that indentured labor was distinguished from free migration, right? So the Indian state actually creates different tiers of who can immigrate and under what conditions. So there's a, Zahra, you probably know better, right? Like there's this kind of like paternalistic way that the Indian state adjudicates migration to the Gulf, especially for people who haven't achieved education haven't beyond a certain level, that sets up a system in which there's like two tiers of immigrants, right? Natasha Iskander has written a book. I haven't had a chance to read it yet about like, it's called Does Skill Make Us Human? I think that would also answer some of what you're talking about. But also fundamentally, I think having people at a higher tier doesn't erase the fact that racial differentiation is happening. I mean, Obama was the president in the United States. Can we really say that racism against Black people doesn't exist in the US? I think that having people distributed through different status levels doesn't take away from the fact that when you look at the most exploited, they tend to come from certain national backgrounds. I don't know if that answers the question or not. I'll put Natasha's.
I would add to that also an element, which is that we do know that at least in the Gulf, many of the South Asians and people of color who are in highly skilled professions here frequently actually have a Western passport as well. And that's another angle of how that relates with with their racial ethnic identity, but the status identity and employment identity in the country is mitigated through the passport. There's not enough data on this, but some previous research that I conducted, survey based on highly skilled migrants in Qatar, this was a very frequent phenomena for migrants from Arab states, from South Asian. I mean, they are of Arab origin, South Asian origin, but actually have an Australian, American, whatever nationality. And that definitely has an impact, at least in terms of how they are functioning in the workplace.
Vani, I see your hand raised.
And also keeping in mind, Indians, Pakistanis combined make the single largest majority in these countries, and they come from extremely feudal, classist and casteist societies. So it's very easy for them to carry forward those biases into the new place that they're working in, very much like driving in the Gulf. Everybody drives the way they drive back home. They operate, they work the same way. So those, the class-based discrimination is also carried forward, and the system incentivizes them to continue doing that.
Wonderful. I'd like to give floor to Khadija Ahmed. Sorry for keeping you waiting so long. Khadija.
Hi, my name is Khadija. I'm from Pakistan. I'm a student here. I wanted to ask more about there's a system of recruitment when it comes to migrant workers, but also I wanted to ask about the carceral systems that come into play when we're talking about racial capitalism, especially in the Gulf. And here I'm particularly talking about how here you have like a lot of licensed practitioners, counselors imported here from Western basically like boards, and they come here and they institutionalize people of color, particularly South Asians, and they're placed under involuntary hold. And because of the kafala system and the sponsorship system, no one can exactly bail them out other than their sponsors. And I wanted you to, and for me, this strikes me as a very carceral system where they're basically on involuntary hold until their sponsor steps in. And I wanted to ask you about how these carceral systems are also come into play when we talk about racial capitalism.
Anybody?
Vani, do you have any specific Qatar info on that? I mean, I could speak a little about work I've done with Pakistani return migrants from Saudi Arabia. It's not Qatar specific, but interviews done with return migrants in Pakistan a few years ago. Many of them had actually spent time in Saudi prisons. I mean, I was quite shocked. About 25% of this group of male migrants I spoke to had spent some duration of time in Saudi Arabia. Definitely left an imprint on them. And usually it was, obviously related to things like not having their ID renewed by their sponsor, not having their karma in time. In some cases, it was actually involved in some illegal activity. They were clearly, it was a big part of the conversation. I wasn't interviewing them because I had no idea they'd been in prison. It was just based on their status as returned migrants. But it certainly had shaped their experiences. And they definitely, I think to an extent, expressed it in a sort of racialized form that, as Pakistanis, they had a certain status and that this was part of the reason that they ended up in prison. And it was because they were so marginalized. A lot of the sort of expressions of their experiences, the ones who had not had good ones in Saudi, was along those lines. We are worse than dogs. I remember one saying, but I don't actually know anything specifically about the castral system that, or, you know, here in Qatar.
I think that immigration-based detention, that is overstaying or being charged of absconding and all of it, that is very racialized even in Qatar. But they try to move the workers out of these detention centers and send them home quickly. In terms of those who are in prison for other activities, like, you know, what's considered under the criminal code for bounce checks or theft or whatever, that is not particularly racial, but in administrative detention and deportation, it tends to be that way.
So, Zoe, do you still have that question? I see your hands.
I think Waf was in line, so that's why I
moved my hand. Okay, so Waf.
Hey, hello everybody. I'm very happy in being here. I've been introduced to this very recently, but learned a lot from everyone that spoke. I just want to make a couple of comments and then a question. And it's my comments are from my experience as well. So living in the US, working in the US, working in Australia before, the employer mindset is what I want to talk about. More like another word that I want to use is stereotyping. I think it has a lot to do with when an employer wants to employ, whether in Qatar or anywhere, I found that it's all about safety. Like, is it safe to hire that person or not? So just, I wanna focus on just on the employer mindset and how we want to change an employer mindset, whether this employer is from Qatar or from Dubai or from anywhere. So I think there is an issue with the trust. Do they trust the non-white cultures or not? There is an issue, I guess, with in the Middle East, we believe that white civilization have done it better. And I think 20, 30 years ago or more, when Dubai wanted to build what we now see in Dubai, is they wanted to do something similar to a Western country or a city. They had more, it looks like a Western country. It looks like Sydney, it looks like Los Angeles. It doesn't look like a Middle Eastern country, right? So I wanna know why this still exists. The stereotyping that somebody, an employee from an international college or a Western experience can do the job better. And if this is true, then how we can change it, right? Because we want to change that mindset. When we change the mindset of employers, I think we are attacking this issue at heart. The other thing is, do we trust the Middle East institutions? Do we trust the education in the Middle East? Like, if I have somebody with the same qualification coming from a degree from a Middle Eastern country, am I gonna have the same amount of trust in their qualification, in their education? If no, then we need to promote more. This takes time. But this is what I felt. Another point is the labor market. In every country that I've been to, you would see some certain type of jobs that nobody would want to do. Like, the employer is okay with employing any nationality, any race, but who is applying? This is another point. You will find that in the United States, you will see the nearest poorest country is Mexico, right? So you will see a lot of Mexican labor doing jobs that the other generations that have been living in the country wouldn't want to do. I think this is nothing to do with the employer. Like, it's about who is applying and who is in need for the job. How they are fixing it here, that takes us to another point, which is the local laws and the regulation. How would this regulate it? Like, when you apply on the same company that I used to work for, if I apply a job in the United States, you will see some questions like, what is your race? Like, this is a standard question that you have to answer when you apply to any job. It's optional, by the way, but they want to know, is it white? Is it non-white? Hispanic, your answers are being taken into consideration to kind of attack issues like what we are talking about now. And they will never ask you, for example, about your current salary. But when you go and apply to the same company, which is an American company, but it's operating in the Middle East, for example, you will find that they are asking different type of questions. What's your nationality? And they will ask you, what is your current salary? You have to say. So it's internal laws and regulations. And who is driving the internal laws and regulations? It's the amount of pressure that the media is putting, right? So I think if I want to move to my question is, what do you think is the solution? So you laid out the issue today very well. Like I learned a lot about the problem, but I want to know what do you think is the solution?
Mm-hmm. Wonderful set of questions. I think there are a couple of multiple questions. So whichever you feel comfortable, our panelists, whichever you feel comfortable, please take it on.
I just want to address two points. One is about when you're talking about safety, we keep hearing this from employers of domestic workers. The justification for controlling their mobility, controlling the access to their personal communication is always, oh, this is our privacy. It's because of the safety. It's quite ridiculous because you trust your children with them, you trust your home with them, but you won't trust themselves to take care of themselves. So this thing is usually just a very flimsy justification to exercise control over cheap labor. Secondly, when you're talking about these are the people who are applying for these jobs, hence these are the nationalities being employed, that doesn't quite apply to the Gulf. There are bilateral agreements being entered into where origin countries are pushing their labor, their citizens. So a bilateral agreement between Uganda and Saudi a few years ago asked for 500,000 Ugandans to be deployed there, or something with Bangladesh, Indonesia, similar stuff. So countries are at a diplomatic level negotiating who's going to be recruited, which nationalities are going to be recruited. And then businesses are given a quota of those visas. You get 20 Nepali visas, you get 10 Indian visas. So it's really not a question of an open labor market where people are applying for jobs that are available. There are all of these things that are taken into consideration.
Thank you, Vani. We are actually at the end of our panel. If you still have few questions and if our panelists have few more minutes to spare, I would like to go about 5 minutes more. And so, Torsten, you can ask your question.
Is that okay with our panel? Are you... Okay, good. Well, thank you so much for this really insightful presentations and this great discussion. I guess I'm wondering, I have a question about, Zahra said earlier to kind of follow the money. And so I wonder how, if there's any work done, being done, or if you have kind of insights on how, in particular kind of multinational corporations manage, like the universities and kind of Education City, right, which are themselves kind of multinational corporations of sorts, how do they manage to, universities, like these universities often have anti-racial discrimination statements. So I wonder if you have any thoughts about how the kind of governance of those kind of corporations and kind of local laws and kind of regulations work together to make this kind of invisible. So to make the kind of the role and agency of these corporations invisible. I mean, it almost, the way you've kind of been describing it all, it almost sounds like this is good for the corporations that all the blame is on the gun cutter. It almost sounds like a kind of PR strategy, for their, that's obviously not, I'm sure that's not like a design kind of strategy, but I'm just kind of wondering how you think those kind of, the kind of internal governance of those corporations and the kind of local laws and kind of work together to do that.
I can start the answer. I'm sure you guys have more detailed things to say. But I think one of the ways, if we look at Education City, and if you also look at what Andrea Wright has written about the oil industry, right, is how subcontracting becomes a very efficient way to remove responsibility from the corporation for things like injury or fair pay. So for example, like in Education City, the janitors, the custodial staff, the security, they're all subcontracted. So even if there was an Education City-wide sort of like, we're going to follow these kinds of labor standards, it would be very easy for them to then say, oh, well, you know, that only applies to people that are directly employed. And that's what's happening in a lot of corporations. And it this kind of like diffusion of responsibility, right?
I think I can add to that, Joyston. So again, for some of the work that I've read, you know, academic work that's tracked how cases were taken, for example, against big companies practicing unfree labor practices, particularly in Brazil, when they, you know, under Lula, they really went after unfree labor and modern day slavery. And so they actually resulted in some court cases against these complex, you know, production chains. One of the ones that I had read about was, I think, a very sort of high-end clothing manufacturer, but it was about the fact that these Brazilian migrant workers, actually Bolivian migrant workers in Brazil, were working as pretty much, you know, unfree labor in these factories or small workshops. Ultimately, they actually proceeded to take a case against the big company, even though the company claimed they didn't know anything about any of these practices and they had just like outsourced it, and there were three or five intermediaries along the way, but they were able to take cases against it. So what I'm saying is that's just how structurally I'm thinking that if, you know, for us, we're doing the research, we need some empirical meat on this. We need to start doing some research on these things. So our goal will not be to like, you know, follow it into legal cases, but to actually start tracing some of this. So that, yeah, that's kind of how I think I'm getting some of my ideas of how it's been done in other challenging things. You know, we talk all the time about unfree labor and modern day slavery, but actually then identifying who's culpable, where is it happening, how is it happening. If it has been possible there, I think some of that could be useful to people thinking of like working on this through the racial capitalism lens, looking at racialization.
So, Vani, do you have anything to add to that?
Just talking about subcontracting, I think Grace put a comment. The problem with, there's an increase in subcontracting over the last 4 or 5 years. In the certain sectors like hospital, all of security is subcontracted. Facilities management, hospitality, catering, within hotel chains. The problem when there are standards, you're dependent on corporate policies and standards to keep subcontractors in check, is only those people who are deployed there will maintain those standards. And if there is a problem in their complaint, and we've seen this repeatedly, they will just shift the workers out of there. If they feel the workers have created a relationship with the direct employees and they're having these conversations, then they just shift them away from there and bring in a new group. We need to avoid this. There are some interesting surveys and data available on the Business and Human Rights Resource Center website that looks at the increasing subcontracting happening across all sectors, because big corporations don't want to take responsibility, right, for these jobs that they consider essential, but too small and too problematic.
Wonderful.
Thank you all. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your insightful presentation, questions, and your responses to those questions. I really enjoyed it thoroughly, and I believe our audience also liked it. Thank you so much for your time, especially during this time of Ramadan. It's very difficult to, organize this kind of events, but we are extremely grateful for you, for your presence and your input in this. And hopefully we will keep our discussions continuing in near future. Thank you everybody for attending, and good night.